Number 1.
Amber was last seen in Pinole, California on June 3, 1988. She was jumping rope with an adult-sized leather jump rope with wooden handles at the time, and was outside in the front yard of her home on Savage Avenue. Her mother, Kim, checked on her after 15 minutes, but by then she was gone. Amber was not usually allowed to play outside by herself, but Kim gave her permission that day, since two neighbors were to arrive when she would be out there. The jump rope she was using disappeared with her. She was never heard from again. Investigators believe that Amber was abducted by a stranger. A witness on her disappearance reported that they had seen a child matching her description at Alvarado Park at some point between 4:45 p.m. and 5 p.m. on the day she vanished. The girl was being held by an adult white male and was seen being forced into a vehicle by the man at the park's entrance. The man was described as standing at 5'73 and weighing 160 pounds. He was approximately 40 years old in 1988. Investigators are not sure if the child seen was Amber, and the man remains unidentified. Extensive searches by dogs, volunteers, and helicopters failed to turn up any trace of Amber. On June 4, authorities discovered a pair of pink socks near her home on a baseball diamond by a creek that flows behind Amber's house. Kim believes that these socks might have belonged to her daughter, but is unsure if they do. The socks were found in the area after it was already searched. Investigators believe that someone placed them there afterwards. There were possible sightings of Amber after her abduction. A Sacramento area couple reported that they spoke to the child on August 2, 1988 in the Sierra Foothills area. A woman in the Calaveras County area told investigators that she was approached by a girl on August 12, 1988. She said the girl identified herself as Amber Jean Swartz Garcia. The sighting occurred in Camp Connell. The woman said Amber disappeared with an unknown couple. The town is just 100 miles north of where Amber disappeared from. The woman stated she did not report the sighting for 2 days, because she did not know who Amber was at the time. She said she reported what she saw when she saw Amber's photograph and information on a milk carton. Authorities also did not investigate the lead immediately, because they failed to get the woman's name and phone number when she called them. Investigators spent eventual days searching for the unidentified couple and came up with composite photographs and looked at vacationers in the area as well. Investigators also put out descriptions of the couple. The man was described as being Caucasian and appeared to be in his early 40s in 1988. He stood at 6 feet 2 inches and weighed approximately 170 pounds. He was said to have brown layered hair. The woman was described as being Caucasian and around 35 years old in 1988. She stood at 5 feet 6 inches and weighed approximately 130 pounds. She had blonde shoulder-length hair that was bleached on top. Investigators believe Amber's presumed abduction might be connected to others that occurred after she disappeared in other places of the Bay Area. On November 19, 1988, Michaela Joy Gericht was abducted from outside of a grocery store near her residence in Hayward, California. She was taken by an unidentified Caucasian male and has never been seen again. On January 30, 1989, Eileen Beth Misheloff was allegedly kidnapped by unknown individuals as she walked home from school in Dublin, California. She was the oldest of the abducted children, she was 13 years old. Her backpack which she was carrying was later found in an area that had already been searched. This leads investigators to suspect her abductors likely placed it there sometime afterwards. On February 4, 1989, 14-year-old Alicia Christopherson was practicing her color guard routines with a wooden baton in the parking lot of the Cherrywood apartment complex on Dakota Road in Union City, California. She noticed that a man jogged past her twice before he came up behind her and grabbed her in an attempt to abduct her. Alicia used self-defense moves to wrench herself free of the man and ran to her parents' apartment. Alicia had been taught to fight back against anyone who tried to subdue her, so she was well prepared for what the man had done to her. Investigators searched for the man by feet and helicopter, but found no sign of Alicia's assailant. The man was described as being approximately 30 years old in 1989. He stood at 6'03" and weighed between 190 and 200 pounds. The man had shoulder length and curly blonde hair as well as a blonde mustache. The man looked as though he had been in the sun. He was reportedly wearing a green baseball cap, a white long-sleeved sweatshirt with athletics written on it in green lettering. He was also wearing green sweatpants as well as blue and white tennis shoes. Investigators have noted that the man sought in Alicia's case bears a similar description to the man who abducted Michaela Garrick just 2 months earlier. The attempted abduction also took place in Union City, California, which is where Michaela's abductor drove towards after taking her. It's unknown if the man who tried taking Alicia had anything to do with the other abductions, but he remains unidentified. On December 27, 1991, Amanda Nicole Eileen Campbell was last seen in Fairfield, California. She was riding her bicycle to a friend's house when she was presumably abducted by a stranger. Her bicycle was later found, but she wasn't. She has never been seen or heard from since 1991. She was 4 years old at the time of her presumed abduction. Several people have emerged as suspects in all of these cases. Timothy Bindner quickly emerged as a possible suspect due to his odd behavior following each abduction. Just 3 days after Amber Swartz Garcia went missing, he went to Amber's house and spoke with her mother, Kim. He told her he was searching the woods nearby for her daughter. Kim recalls Bindner saying, "I wanted to be the one who saved her. I wanted to be the one to bring her home to you." Kim said she wanted nothing to do with Bindner after he said they were looking for a dead body. But he was persistent and continued to offer his assistance in searching for Amber after her presumed abduction. After Michaela was abducted, Bindner showed up to the home of Michaela, where he talked with Sharon. He asked her if he could help her find her missing daughter. He said he wanted to go out and look for Michaela, and he even brought a map and showed the locations he wanted to go to. After Amanda Campbell went missing in 1991, Bindner's name once again resurfaced in all the cases. Just months before she was taken, a couple in her neighborhood contacted police and told them that their 12-year-old daughter was receiving odd mail. The mail was written backwards, so it could only be read in a mirror. The letter was from Bindner, and it turned out that he was writing to a lot of young girls and often sent them birthday greetings. He told authorities he did this because all the girls seemed lonely. He was questioned by Pinole police after he was seen repeatedly visiting the grave of 5-year-old Angela Jane Bugay in Oakmont Cemetery. Angela was abducted from her apartment complex in Antioch, California. She shared the apartment with her mother and brother at the time of her abduction. A few days later, Angela's remains were found in a shallow grave located in a nearby field. She had been sexually assaulted and suffocated to death. Her murderer was not identified at the time. Bindner repeatedly denied any involvement in all the cases he was linked to and said he had never met any of the missing girls before their abductions. He stated he was deeply affected by all the cases and wanted to try and help in any way he could. However, his constant presence in these cases were not the only noticeable things that popped up in the investigations. Bindner once wrote a letter to law enforcement and speculated that the next child to be abducted would be 9 years old. Soon afterwards, Michaela was abducted from Hayward. On another occasion, Bindner sent a Christmas card to a FBI profiler with an image of a little girl holding up 4 fingers. Shortly after this, Amanda Campbell was abducted at 4 years old. Police bloodhounds also picked up the scent of Amber Swartz Garcia at the grave of Angela Bugay. This was a red flag since Bindner often visited the gravesite. Some agencies say he went to that location up to 90 times a year. Police dogs later traced the scent of Amanda Campbell to Angela's grave. Investigators in the Campbell case questioned Bindner, and he was named a suspect in the missing persons case in 1992. Investigators were considering pressing charges against Bindner for kidnapping, but bloodhound evidence is too unreliable to be presented as evidence in a court or trial. A Mercury News reporter wanted to interview Bindner about the cases. He accepted her offer, but requested to be interviewed at Oakmont Cemetery in the middle of the night. She picked him up at 4:30 a.m., and he asked to play his favorite song on the car radio. The song was "Jesus, Here's Another Child to Hold." They drove to the cemetery per the request. The reporter asked him why he was so concerned over the missing girls. He replied that he saw them as his old children. He stated he cried for them, prayed for them, and that he spent a lot of his time thinking about them and dedicated himself to finding them. He then said something that came as shock. Bindner was asked what he thought happened to the girls when they were taken. He replied, "Well, you know, one of them was sweet and shy and didn't say a thing, but the other went kicking and screaming." "Then," she said, he added, "I'm just guessing that that's what they would have said." The reporter said she got chills. Investigators and the families of the girls believe Bindner was toying with them. He noticeably went out of his way to convince the reporter that he was involved in the abductions of the girls. At the urging of police, Kim Swartz-Garcia formed a friendship with Bindner in an effort to learn more about her daughter's disappearance. She agreed that it all seemed like a game to him. She believes he got off on taunting her and her family. At his suggestion, Kim read a book called Crime and Punishment in which the character who keeps showing up turns out to be the man who committed the crime in question. Bindner has called himself a good Samaritan and said he was simply trying to find the missing girls. In 1989, Bindner was given a reward of heroism by the California Highway Patrol for assisting in the rescue efforts after the earthquake. He maintains his innocence in the cases. He even won a defamation of character lawsuit against Amanda Campbell's hometown for $90,000. Investigators believe Bindner might have also been involved in the presumed abduction of Tara Lasset Cossey, who went missing from San Pedro, California on June 6, 1979. She left her residence to go, but sugar for her mother and never returned. There's no evidence that Bindner is involved in this case, but due to the proximity and location and time period, he is being investigated in the case. Bindner was considered a suspect in Angela Bugay's abduction and murder for over a decade after her death until authorities uncovered her true killer. In 1995, DNA testing revealed a semen sample found on Angela's body belonged to a 44-year-old man, Larry Graham. He was arrested for Angela's murder and charged in April of 1996. Larry once dated Angela's mother and had a history of sexual offenses against children. He was their neighbor at the time of Angela's murder. In 2003, Larry was convicted of killing Angela and was sentenced to death for the crime. He took his own life in his jail cell in 2009. He is not considered a suspect in the other cases. In November of 1995, investigators searched the residence of one of Amber's old neighbors for possible evidence relating to her abduction. The home belonged to a man, Douglas Lee Jamison, of Richmond. He was a friend of Amber's family in 1988, and he was questioned after her abduction, but was not considered a suspect in the case. Kim told the media that the house was searched following a tip sent to investigators. Kim said she knew Douglas through her former husband, Al Garcia. She said she had not seen Douglas in several years by then. She stated that Amber liked Douglas very much and thought he was a nice man. Douglas was cooperative with investigators and agreed to let them search his residence. Several items were removed from the home, but none seemed to implicate Douglas in Amber's abduction. In June of 2002, investigators named a defrocked priest, Stephen Kiesel, as a suspect in Amber's presumed abduction. Kiesel allegedly molested three girls while working on the Santa Paula Church in the in between 1968 and 1971. They came forward years later with their stories of the crimes. Investigators charged him with the three molestations. He is also suspected of molesting another girl while he worked at the St. Joseph's Church in Pinole from 1972 to 1976. He worked there again in 1985. Three other girls claimed Kiesel molested them in the Santa Church in the late 1970s. It's also possible he molested three girls who were aged 8 to 9 at the Tahoe Donner Golf Course while they were on a family outing. Kiesel pleaded no contest to lewd for tying up and sexually molesting two boys who were 11 and 12 years old at the time. The incident took place in the rectory of Our Lady of the Rosary Church in Union City. Investigators found out that he lived 14 houses away from Amber's residence at the time of her abduction. Amber bore similarities to the girls he molested prior to her disappearance. Kim recalls him as a simple man who lived in their neighborhood. Kiesel was not questioned about Amber's disappearance in 1988 due to his criminal record being expunged. Kim did not believe he had anything to do with Amber's disappearance, but felt his criminal record should be investigated. Investigators have also named him as a suspect in two Nevada missing children cases. Anthony Bernard Frank went missing from Lemon Valley, Nevada on May 8, 1983. He was last seen in the morning while walking to school. He was allegedly seen speaking with a driver of a still unidentified rusted vehicle. Investigators believe the boy was abducted and likely murdered. It's unknown why they came to suspect him in Anthony's case. Jennifer Martin was last seen in Reno, Nevada on June 28, 1987. She was last seen after purchasing candy and a soda at the 7-Eleven convenience store near her home. She left the store and was seen walking home, but she never made it. Investigators have always believed she was taken by a stranger. Investigators searched his residence and yard three times for evidence relating to the cases. They also suspected Kiesel might have been involved in the 1991 California abduction of J.C. Lee Dugard. Investigators only found a bag with decomposing clothing in it. The searches concluded in July of 2002. Investigators at one point believed the cases were connected to another missing California girl. On June 10, 1991, J.C. Lee Dugard left her residence in South Lake Tahoe, California to go and wait at the bus stop for her school bus to pick her up. J.C. was abducted by an unidentified couple who pulled her into a car and sped off. She was 11 years old at the time of her abduction. JC's female abductor was described as being a 32 years old in 1991 who stood at 5'53". The woman had long black hair with a dark complexion. The vehicle that was used in the abduction was described as a late model 1980 gray Ford sedan. JC's abductors remained unidentified for many years after her witnessed abduction. James Anthony DeVeggio has been considered a possible suspect in all the abductions for many years, including JC's. He, along with his girlfriend, Michelle Micho, were charged with the abduction, rape, and murder of Vanessa Lay Swanson in 1997. Swanson's body was discovered just 5 miles away from where JC was taken years earlier. Both were previously charged with a few counts of sexual assault in unrelated cases in the mid-1990s. They were both convicted of killing Vanessa in 2002 and were sentenced to death for their crimes. Investigators interviewed them both about JC's disappearance, and Micho claimed she met DeVeggio in 1996, so she couldn't have abducted JC. However, JC's stepfather Carl Probin, who witnessed her abduction, said that Micho matches the description of the woman who grabbed JC. There were striking similarities between the two of them. However, federal investigators created a timeline which tracked DeVeggio and Micho's whereabouts over the 1980s and 1990s, and this information deemed it unlikely that they had abducted JC. On August 26, 2009, JC was found alive and safe in Antioch, California. She had been abducted by a sex offender, Philip Garrido, and his wife, Nancy. She was held captive in their backyard for 18 years and was isolated, so she was unaware of the widespread search for her and the two people who took her. JC was sexually abused and raped while held captive and gave birth to two girls while being held. She and her daughters have since been reunited with JC's mother, Terry Probin. Investigators do not believe Philip was involved in Amber's presumed abduction, but he has been considered a possible suspect in Michaela's abduction and Eileen's disappearance. Curtis Dean Anderson is considered a strong suspect in Amber's disappearance. He is suspected of killing at least 8 children throughout the United States. On December 9, 1999, he abducted 7-year-old Shauna Fairchild from Vallejo, California. She disappeared while walking to catch the school bus. Fairchild's skull was found in the Los Gatos Hills 14 months after her abduction. He was a suspect in her disappearance for some time, after he kidnapped an 8-year-old girl from Vallejo, California, while she walked home from school. She managed to escape captivity. He was arrested for kidnapping and killing Shauna in 2004. He was convicted of killing her and was sentenced to over 300 years in prison. In November of 2007, Curtis was interviewed by federal agents, and he reportedly confessed to Amber's abduction and murder. He was known to frequent the Pinole area and knew it pretty well. He told investigators that he was driving from the Bay Area to his aunt's residence in Arizona and wanted company while he drove. He decided to take a detour off the highway and onto Amber's street at the time. He said he saw the child playing in her front yard and pulled her into his vehicle. He stated that he kept Amber sedated with root beer schnapps and reportedly took her to a motel room in Tucson, Arizona, where he killed her by suffocating her about a day and a half after her abduction. He said he stuffed Amber's body into the trunk of his car. Anderson stated he attempted to cross the border into Mexico, but he was denied to cross by border agents because he was too intoxicated. Anderson said he disposed of Amber's body in a remote area off Highway 10 while he was on his way to his aunt's ranch near Benson, Arizona. A FBI profiler said he was convinced Anderson was telling the truth. He labeled Anderson as a sociopath who showed no remorse for his crimes. Anderson died in prison on December 9, 2007. He was to be questioned and polygraphed about his confession to Amber's disappearance. Investigators spent 18 months investigating Anderson's confession and found no evidence to refute it nor support it. However, authorities labeled her abduction as solved and said they were closing the case. Kim Swartz Garcia did not agree with closing the case and petitioned to have it reopened. She believes Curtis's confession to her daughter's murder is false and that Amber might still be alive. Eventually, Pinole police reopened the case and continue to seek answers in her disappearance. Curtis is also a suspect in the 1999 abduction of Carla Rodriguez, who is still missing as of currently. After Amber's abduction, Kim founded the Amber Foundation for Missing Children. The foundation was dedicated to assisting in missing children's cases. Amber's father, Floyd Swartz, was a police officer before his daughter's birth. He was killed while chasing down a murder suspect in May of 1980. He died months before his daughter was taken. Investigators do not believe the man who killed her father was involved in her case, since he was on death row in 1988. Amber's abduction remains unsolved and her case has received quite a bit of media attention in recent years. Investigators have been unable to identify Amber's abductor, and her presumed abduction was not witnessed. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact Pinole Police Department 510-724-8950.
Number 2.
Michael was last seen in San Francisco, California on January 25, 1989. He packed up his school stuff, which included his school books and his clarinet, into his bag and left his home at 7:30 a.m. to go to school. It was later learned that the school was closed that day. It's possible that Michael was unaware of this. He was seen later that morning near the area of 9th and Harrison Street. He was also seen later in the afternoon at 7th and Market Streets. He was alone during the two times he was sighted. Michael never returned home and was never seen or heard from again. His duffel bag that he was carrying was found by a couple on February 21, 1989. It was discovered by a couple on the rocks below the cliff house. This was a favorite spot of Michael's family to fish. The discovery wasn't reported until early March, when the couple found out about his disappearance. Park rangers found the bag on the beach by that time. They found a part of Michael's clarinet inside of the bag. Investigators believe that Michael may have been abducted by someone he did not, but the circumstances of his disappearance are unclear. His disappearance remains unsolved. His parents have both stated that he was a good student and performed in the school band. He remains missing, and there's been no sign of him since 1989. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact San Francisco Police Department 415-558-5515.
Number 3.
Monique was last seen in Albany, New York on March 29, 1990. She was last seen at approximately 8 a.m. as she prepared to leave for school. Her mother, Annie Graniella, was at work when she received a phone call from Monique at 12 p.m. Monique said she missed the school bus and would stay home for the day. She returned to the residence during the evening hours and discovered that Monique was missing. Graniella waited 8 hours to report her daughter missing, because she thought investigators would not take the report unless the child had been missing for an extended period of time. Investigators started to search for Monique, but found no evidence due to the period of time it took to report her missing. Authorities suspect that Monique was abducted by a stranger and possibly killed afterwards. Investigators have looked at the possibility that Monique's stepfather may have known someone who could have been involved in her presumed abduction. He was in prison at the time of her disappearance. Investigators considered that he may have gotten into an altercation with an inmate and that the inmate abducted Monique to get revenge towards him. They later determined that his prison sentence had no relation to her disappearance. It should also be noted that Monique and her mother relocated to Albany from New York City after a murder occurred in front of their residence. It's possible that Monique might have witnessed the crime, but they have no evidence that the murder is connected to her case. Child killer Louis Lent has been investigated for possible involvement in Santiago's case. He was convicted of murdering Massachusetts child Jimmy Bernardo, a 12-year-old boy who was murdered in 1990, and was also charged with killing 12-year-old Sarah Wood, who was abducted and killed in New York in 1993. Her body has never been recovered. Investigators have attempted to see if Lent could be involved in other cases. He's a suspect in the 1992 Massachusetts disappearance of 16-year-old James Lusher, who disappeared while riding his bike to his grandmother's home. Lent has since confessed to the crime and led investigators to a pond where he allegedly disposed of the body. James has not been found. Lent is also considered a possible suspect in the 1985 New York disappearance of Karen Wilson, the 1986 New York disappearance of Tammy McCormick, and the Maine disappearance of Kimberly Moreau. Investigators have not found any evidence that Lent was involved in Monique's case. An adult male who was acquainted with Monique admitted to taking her to the State University of Albany campus about 5 days before her disappearance. He did not have permission from Monique's mother to take her there. He had seen Monique in the parking lot on Central Avenue and felt sorry for her. He purchased her snacks at the school cafeteria. He admitted to secretly masturbating while she waited in line. He was questioned in her disappearance less than 2 days after she went missing. He signed a typed written statement. He was not charged in Monique's disappearance and maintains his innocence in her case. He does not have a criminal record and stated some of his admissions were fabricated by investigators. Both of Monique's parents have since died from AIDS-related causes. Her disappearance remains unsolved and foul play is possible in her case. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact Albany Police Department 518-462-8058.
Number 4.
Sarah Wood was last seen in Litchfield, New York on August 18, 1993. She was last seen riding her bike from the Norwich Corners Church, which is located on Roberts Road and Graffenburg Road. She attended summer Bible school there. She was returning to her home on Hackettam Road at the time she went missing. She was carrying poster board, a church song book, and 8x10 transparencies as she rode her bike. It was determined that Sarah made it safely down Roberts Road and was last seen traveling up a steep hill on Hackettam Road. She was only 0.4 miles away from her home at the time. She never made it home and was never seen or heard from again. Sarah's bicycle, which was described as a pink and white 10-speed mountain bicycle, was found later that evening after she didn't return home. The materials she was carrying were found scattered in a brush area, and the bike was standing against a tree. The area of discovery was several hundred feet off of Hackettam Road. Investigators believe that Sarah was abducted. In 1994, Lewis Lent was charged with kidnapping and killing Sarah on the day of her disappearance. He stated that he abducted Sarah by force as she rode her bike. He then forced her into the woods where he raped her and then beat her to death with a tree branch shaped like a club. He initially stated he had buried Sarah's body in a clearing near Raquette Lake in the Adirondack Mountains. A search of that region turned up no sign of her body, and Lent later admitted that he lied about the location. He said she was buried in a shallow grave, but refused to say where because he apparently buried another victim's body nearby. He was convicted of the charges and sentenced to life in prison. He was convicted of murdering Massachusetts child, Jimmy Bernardo, a 12-year-old boy who was murdered in 1990. He was returned to Massachusetts after his trial in Sarah's case to serve his sentence for his murder. Investigators have attempted to see if Lent could be involved in other cases. Lent is also considered a possible suspect in the 1985 New York disappearance of Karen Wilson, the 1986 New York disappearance of Tammy McCormick, the 1986 Maine disappearance of Kimberly Moreau, and the 1990 possible abduction of Monique Santiago, who disappeared from New York. Lent is also the prime suspect in the Massachusetts 1992 disappearance of James Lusher Jr., who went missing while he rode his bike to his grandmother's home. Lent confessed to killing Lusher in 2013, but investigators have yet to recover his body. He was in the area when Lusher went missing. Sarah was a cheerleader when she disappeared. Her family founded the Sarah Ann Wood Rescue Center, which was later renamed as the Mohawk Valley branch of the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Investigators have been unable to find the location of Sarah's body, but they strongly believe foul play is the reason for her disappearance. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact New York State Police 315-866-7111.
Number 5.
James was last seen in Westfield, Massachusetts on November 6, 1992. He planned to ride his bike from his father's home to his grandmother's home in Blandford, Massachusetts, and also wanted to watch a bicycle race in the area. The trip was a 12-mile ride, but Jamie never made it and was never heard from again. James was allegedly sighted at a Friendly's restaurant on November 8. This was 2 days after he went missing. The sighting was given to investigators by a server at the restaurant. On November 11, a hunter found James' bike in a wooded area of Westfield. His bike was described as a gray-green Huffy mountain bicycle. He had gotten it just 3 weeks before his disappearance. The bike was found near a pond. Investigators drained the pond in search of James and conducted numerous air and ground searches. No trace of him was ever found. James was initially assumed to be a runaway by both police and his family, but they soon concluded it unlikely that he ran away. Foul play is now suspected in his case. child killer, Louis Lent, as the primary suspect in Lusher's disappearance. He was convicted of murdering Massachusetts child, Jimmy Bernardo, a 12-year-old boy who was murdered in 1990, and was also charged with killing 12-year-old Sarah Wood, who was abducted and killed in New York in 1993. Her body has never been recovered. Investigators have attempted to see if Lent could be involved in other cases. Lent is also considered a possible suspect in the 1985 New York disappearance of Karen Wilson, the 1986 New York disappearance of Tammy McCormick, the 1986 Maine disappearance of Kimberly Moreau, and the 1990 possible abduction of Monique Santiago, who disappeared from New York. Lent was in an area near Westfield at the time of Jamie's disappearance. In July of 2013, Lewis confessed to killing James and disposing of his body in a pond known as Greenwater Pond. A search was initiated at the pond, which is 88 acres wide and could reach depths of 58 feet. They searched the pond for 3 days and stopped when they failed to yield any trace of Jamie or his body. At the time of his disappearance, James was enrolled at Westfield Alternative School as a special needs student. His father described him as an immature and bossy teenager who did not like school and had few friends at the time. He lived with his father since his parents had divorced, and the relationship between them was strained. James remains missing and his body has never been found. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact Westfield Police Department 413-562-5411.
Number 6.
Kathleen Kelly disappeared at a time when it wasn't unusual for children to walk the streets of a small Pennsylvania borough in the twilight of a late spring day. Kathleen, whom everyone called Kathy, was walking home alone in Springdale Borough, Allegheny County, when she disappeared on May 22, 1981. It was the start of Memorial Day weekend, and Kathleen had been skating at the chess arena in neighboring Cheswick. It was nothing at that time for her to walk from one end of Springdale to another, said her older sister, Judy Stanko. It wasn't rare for Kathleen to leave the rink by herself. She would do that. Stanko, 73, of Lower Burrell, was the last person to see Kathleen and wants the peace of knowing what happened to her little sister. My mother always prayed that she would live long enough to see Kathleen again. Now we're at the point where I hope I live long enough to see her again, she said. Kathleen was born in California, along with her brother, Robert, who was about 5 years older. After her father died, her mother, Annabelle Kelly, moved the two of them to Pittsburgh to be closer to family, Stanko said. Stanko, who already had a family of her own, had remarried and was living on Maxwell Avenue in Springdale, about 6 blocks from her mother and 2 siblings. Much of their free time was spent at the chess arena, where Stanko was a floor guard and her husband, John, was an assistant manager. Now slated for demolition, the roller rink was a popular destination in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s. That was the thing to do on the weekends, to roller skate, Stanko said. The kids would skate there and then go bowling all night. Kathleen often went to the rink with her brother-in-law, John, and her older nieces and nephews. She was especially close with her niece, Kimberly, who was about 4 years older. Kathy was my aunt, but she was more like my baby sister, said Kimberly Robertson, Judy Stanko's second youngest child. Robertson, 51, of Middle River, Maryland, believes Kathleen disappeared in 1980, not in 1981, the year listed on the NamUs.gov and CharlieProject.org missing person websites. On the night of Kathleen's disappearance, the kids all piled into John Stanko's car and went over to the chess arena. At some point, Kathleen left by herself and walked the 8 blocks to her sister's house. Although she was the mother of 4 teenagers, Stanko was home alone at the time with an infant daughter, Jeanine. I said, "What are you doing here?" She said, "Oh, it's boring down there. I don't want to be down there anymore," Stanko said. So we talked for a while. We talked about the baby and the skating rink. Kathleen stayed for about an hour and then decided to go home, which was about 6 blocks away. Stanko can't recall whether it was dark yet. I said to her, "Are you sure you want to walk home?" She said, "Yeah, I'll be fine," Stanko said, noting that she felt Kathleen was being evasive. "I truly thought she had plans, but didn't want me to know what the plans were," she said. Robertson believes Kathleen was not abducted, but rather left of her own volition, because of problems she was having at home. My personal opinion is that Kathleen left. She wasn't taken. How she can leave and survive, I have no idea. She would have needed help, she said. Robertson remembers feeling a sense of relief at Kathleen's departure. My initial thought was, thank God she's gone, and out of that house, she said. Then it was, I lost my best friend. I never thought she would never come back. Once it was apparent that Kathleen was missing, the Springdale police were called. They questioned friends and family members, but, ultimately, treated Kathleen's disappearance as a runaway case. They insisted she was a runaway, and that she'd be home by Monday at the latest, Stanko said, noting that there was no organized public campaign to find Kathleen. 9 or 10 years later, Robertson was at home in Springdale one day, and received a mysterious phone call from someone she believes was Kathleen. I remember getting a phone call that just said, you know who I am and I'm fine. That was it. There was nothing else, she said. Other times, there would be phone calls, but silence on the other end. When Robertson would inquire, Kathy, is that you, the person would hang up. Robertson wants Kathleen to know, if she is still alive, that it's okay to come home. I don't feel like she's gone. I just feel like she's far away, she said. Her message to Kathleen is something the two of them said to each other when they were younger, love you near and far. Kathleen's disappearance remains unsolved and her family remains hopeful that she is alive and will return home someday. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact Springdale Police Department 724-274-9022.
Number 7.
Rachel Green was last seen in Newtown, New Hampshire on March 22, 1980. She purchased a pack of cigarettes and a pack of chewing gum at Rose Corner Market. The store was located on Route 108. She paid $5 for them and took her change. She left the store between 9 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. and intended on walking to a friend's home in the 50 block of North Main Street. She planned to spend the night at that location. Rachel never arrived to her friend's home and was never seen or heard from again. She was reported missing at 10 a.m. the next day by her parents when she never returned. Investigators initially believed that Rachel had run away from home. She left all of her personal belongings behind, which included her dental retainer. Some investigators still hold the theory that she left. A witness stated they had seen the girl on the night she disappeared. She was observed speaking to three male acquaintances who were in a dark-colored car near the market. The men all had bad reputations and were involved in criminal activities. One of these men would later get arrested and convicted of assault and rape. At some point after she disappeared, one of the men confessed to killing Rachel and that her body would be found off Route 108. Investigators dug at a site in search of her remains. Nothing was found, and no charges were filed. It's unclear if any of the men had a role in her disappearance. While the runaway theory is still considered in the case, investigators have looked into other possibilities such as that Rachel met with foul play and is deceased. At the time of her disappearance, Rachel was a freshman at Sanborn Regional High School. She sometimes skipped school so that she could go smoke and drink with other teenagers in the wooded area near Maple Valley. She was rebellious at the time and resented her parents' rules and the fact that she had to babysit her siblings. She had a good relationship with her siblings at the time, and her loved ones describe her as a friendly, outspoken, and fun-loving person. Rachel owned a horse at the time, and her family said she would not have left the animal behind. Rachel's disappearance remains unsolved and her case is classified as a non-family abduction due to the lack of evidence present in her case. If you have any information concerning this case, please contact Rockingham County Sheriff's Office 603-679-2225.